Welcome to the advanced, keep it down back there. Welcome to the advanced class for advanced players, 1800 plus. If you're less than 1800, I'll let you leave now. Okay, good. All right. Well, if you're less than 1800, you probably don't even know it, because, you know, what do you know? Okay. How do you even dress yourself in the morning? All right, so I want to talk about the Sinquefield Cup, and first I'll talk about the players, and then we'll look at a couple of the games and discuss them in detail. Now, Magnus Carlsen has been the number one player in the world for years, or as they say in Michigan, who? Gata Kamsky was the top American player for many years. Hikaru Nakamura has surpassed and is now the top American player. And Levon Aronian, the world's best bughouse player, in case you didn't watch the previous video where I also said that several times. Who is the second ranked player in the world? And Levon not having his best tournament, but again, there's only six rounds, so losing one game could make the tournament bad for you. Now, the best game of the tournament, in my opinion, not anybody else's, was played in round one between world number one, Magnus Carlsen, and the only player in the event who has played a world championship match, Gata Kamsky, who played against Anatoly Karpov and did not win. Later in the year, we'll see Magnus become the world champion when he beats Nishianand. Now, not that I'm saying that's going to definitely happen, but that is going to definitely happen. Magnus played knight f3. Like any super 2800 GM, he plays every first move except f4. Knight f6, c4. Gata likes to play two different defenses against d4 and c4, either the Grunfeld, or as we see in this case, the Slav. And Gata likes the a6 Slav thrown in with g6 usually. He likes to play all those moves. Knight c3, and Gata has to play a6. Now, back in the day, before all of you were born, although Ken West had actually retired by this time, Gata used to play queen b6. And he played it a lot. And he played it even when his opponents knew he was going to play it. And he still didn't lose every game immediately, which he should, because that's ridiculous. But he played it at least 50 times, and he eventually gave it up, although he wasn't really having terrible results with it. Okay, but, well, since that's awful, he now plays a6, which is not as bad. And I have played every move here with white. I've played cd5, c5, a4, e3, and bishop g5. And I lose with all of them. And e3 was played by Magnus. Now, I was shocked here that Gata didn't play some kind of g6, because Gata likes to play a6 and g6. That's his favorite thing to do. And if you watch the US Championship this year, you'll notice he did that against Conrad Holt and against Onishuk, and he didn't have trouble in either game, winning one and drawing the other. He likes to play the G6 lines, which I also like to play, except I always lose when I play them. Now, Gata played another move, Bishop F5, which is also very popular, and this is very good for one of the tournament, reporters, Grandmaster Alejandro Ramirez, because in his match with Tomaszewski for the World Cup, Tomaszewski played queen b3, and Alejandro played rook a7, defending his b-pawn, and that game was eventually drawn, I believe. But the reason it's good is, in the comments for the game, Alejandro mentioned that game, since he played it, so he knew the game well. And when I was doing the live commentary this tournament with Ian Rogers, Ian expected queen b3, and he was surprised that Magnus played bishop d3, thinking this was innocuous. In fact, Magnus earlier in the earlier game played bishop to e2, even more passive. Okay, so bishop d3, not going for an advantage, just going for some random playable position. And now e6. And unlike most of the people in the audience, black puts all of his pieces on white squares, all of his pieces? All of his pawns on white squares. I shouldn't call them pieces, because Liam wouldn't like that. And the bishop is normally blocked, but he's already traded his bishop. And if you saw the game today between Kamsky and Aronian, he basically did the same thing with white. He traded his bishop and put all his pawns on the same color, eventually getting advantage, then disadvantage, then draw. Very suspicious. castles. And now white is eventually going to play e4, so Kamsky plays bishop to b4. Although many grandmasters don't play this way, they simply move their knight out, bishop out in castle, and they don't care if white plays e4. And after bishop to d2, Gata uncharacteristically took a lot of time and played a very strange move. Normally you would just castle here. And, well, some people, Ian was one of them, was interested in the move knight takes d5. Okay, but I can only show that in the advanced class, because that's very advanced. Knight takes d5. Knight takes d5 is forced. Pawn takes d5. Bishop takes d2. Now, you can see why God is such a strong player. He must have foreseen this position on move 4. Because now if pawn takes pawn, pawn takes pawn doesn't win the rook because we have rook a7. Genius. So we take the bishop, we take the pawn, and that's just equal. So I don't think he was afraid of that, although maybe he was afraid that white would get equality. No. So he made a very strange decision. Instead of making a normal move like castles, he took the knight, which is not the best. And white got a nice advantage because black was pretty passive. So he played a4, locking down the queen side, which we actually saw Aronian do today against Kamsky in a similar way, although not as good when Aronian did it. And then a5. And the idea is, it's hard for black to do anything. Black can't move his a-pawn, because I said so. If black moves his b-pawn, he weakens his queenside pawn structure. If he moves his c-pawn, he opens up this bishop, and he can't play e5. Maybe that explains the crazy move he made soon. So knight e4, good square for the knight. Bishop b4, forcing rook to e8. Rook a to c1. And now Gata played a move I didn't understand, but I thought it was me. But it wasn't me, it was him. Okay? You know how many times I've heard that in my life? It was h5. Okay, terrible. Yeah, just the worst move. And any move is better. I've never been so mad. Later, this was a pretty good move, but not now. So Magnus didn't do a good job of punishing this move. Gata likes to play h5, and as we saw today, h4 and h5, to gain space and possibly set up an attack, which due to white's lackluster play actually worked. Knight c7 is, knight e5 I should say, is a good move. Queen c7, knight takes, queen takes. This is all fine for white. Queen to e2, threatening the pawn. Knight to f6, he saw it. Rook d1, queen c7. Now, why did he play queen c7? He wants to play knight to g4, and then if queen to f1, then mate. No, okay. And, yeah, advanced class, right. And he'd like white to move all these pawns up and weaken his own king. And he wants white to play h3 to stop knight g4. So when he plays knight back to e4, this knight stays here forever, and if white tries to kick it out, we have something like this. This is black's plan. So queen c7 actually made sense. h3 was played, stopping knight g4. Rook ad8. Uh-oh. b3, time to buy a new computer. Good. b3. Rook to d7. And now, Carlsen seemed quite confused. Now, of course, any book and any strong player who read that book will tell you a queen and knight is better than a queen and bishop. But any of my students will tell you a queen and bishop is better for the simple reason that it is better. So they want to be right, okay, as we learn from this game. And while in this position, nobody can do very much, but since the position is closed, that would be to black's advantage, because the bishop can't do very much. But as Jeremy Silman wrote in his very odd books series about, you know, the opposite of what you think is true, if the position is closed, that means that black can't open it up, because that opens it up for the bishop. So black can't do anything, so white's better. And the other reason why it's better with the queen and bishop is if we trade pieces and we get to an ending, bishop against knight, rook and bishop against rook and knight, we have the advantage. Now here, this is relatively equal except for this stupid move. So this knight's always defending this pawn. And because it's on a white square, white has the excellent idea of getting his bishop over here, where it's really strong, because you can't kick the bishop out. And this is permanently weak. If you play h4, I can often take it, which happens later in the game. Unfortunately, for the good of chess, Magnus didn't do any of that. Magnus played very wishy-washy here, okay? Didn't play well. Then later in the game, he played incredibly well, so he had to prepare himself for his great play. Didn't want to play well right now. Rook c2, queen d8, then rook c1. Very suspicious. Now, this made Gata overconfident, because white's play doesn't make any sense, so he decided to play super aggressively and punish his opponent. Now, this actually worked, and as was said by many people, in fact, the person who did say, I don't remember, but they compared this to the Ali strategy of the rope-a-dope. Right, Ken West? Okay. And well, I didn't like what he was doing, so I called it the dope-a-dope. Okay, not so good. And Spencer and Joe called it something else. Now, rope-a-dope strategy is, I'm not going to do anything. And then black says, I'm going to crush you. And then if it was the US Championship, then black would crush white. And then we'd be like, ah, that was stupid, and Kamsky's great, and all that kind of stuff. But Kamsky somewhat overreached in this position, and then due to the brilliant defensive play by Magnus Carlsen, very accurate computer moves, almost certainly cheating, but probably not, white was able to win the game. And this was incredible, because H5 is a really stupid move, and I wish Gata was here so I could tell him that. So I hope you're watching this video. But later in the game, he made it look like it was a genius move, and he had a big attack, and it backfired. So it was a very strange game. We're like, that's really stupid. Then, hey, that's really great. Then, I was stupid again. Too bad. And he played H4. And finally, Magnus played bishop e1 to get his bishop to the correct side of the board where it can actually do something. Knight to e4. Again, if g3, I can hop in here. And the queen defends the pawn. And here Magnus made an incredible decision. He egged the black pawns forward so that black's king would be weak and the attack wouldn't work. He played queen g4, threatening the pawn. g5, and then black plays f5, and black starts attacking, and that's what Magnus wanted. Now Magnus has winning chances and losing chances. And he played this very nice move, c takes d5. The idea behind c takes d5, normally black would take with this pawn, keeping the c-file closed, but now it's very difficult to play f5, and f3 seems to just win the game. If knight's f6, I take. If knight to d6, I play bishop takes h4. And you can't play knight to g3 because... So you can't play the normal way. You can't take with the rook because queen takes knight. So probably the best thing to do was to play f5, which was played. Again, black wants to play e takes, so Magnus played queen f3, keeping on this pawn. And now black should play rook takes d5. And this keeps the c-file closed. And my computer program says the position is about equal. White, of course, will move his queen away and then play f3 and e4 and try to win the game. Black will get counterplay with rook to b5, attacking this pawn. And Gata made an error here, I believe. He took with the c-pawn. And he figured, I'm going to have a mating attack. I'm going to put my rook over here somewhere, so I'm not playing rook takes d5. And okay, I gave white the c-file, but so what? If he gets a c-file and I mate him, he can have the c-file. So he played c-takes, which is almost certainly an error. Rook to c2, which not only prepares to double on the c-file, but even more importantly, probably, it defends over here, the rook defending along the second rank, which is very important for later in the game. Rook g7, rook here. And we've said this many times during the commentary, although we don't follow the rule ourselves, but we say it a lot, so that's something to go for it. A lot of times when you're playing chess, you're making moves in 1 to 5 minutes, or if you're Julian, 1 to 5 seconds. Okay, or if you're, joke's not working out well. If you're Owen, 0.1 to 0.5 seconds. Okay, now, super grandmasters occasionally take a lot of time for one move, and usually right out of the opening when they don't know the theory anymore or they're out of their preparation, and sometimes in the middle game or end game when they don't know what to do. Usually this is a bad sign. You're not going to solve chess while you're playing it, so you have to play based on what you know. And if you calculate variations and it takes you 30 minutes, then, you know, back to the tactics trainer. So when a super grandmaster thinks 15, 20, 25 minutes, it's because they don't know what to do and they can't figure out what to do and they're confused. And that's exactly what happened to Gata here. Gata thought a long time here and he just made a bad move. Gata has to play aggressively, and instead he played knight f6, okay, which is an error. And now he's very close to losing. However, to prove that he's losing, white had to make many, many super accurate moves. And the typical player would, well, probably get crushed by Kamsky's attack, but Magnus just played several fantastic moves, and many of these moves were the first moves suggested by Houdini. Some of them we didn't think Magnus would play, but he played them all. Again, cheating. Okay. Now, in this position, black's going to play g4. And white knows that. That's why black made 27 preparatory moves to play g4. So it makes some sense to move your queen. Magnus played queen d1, suggested by, now I, in my opinion, I didn't talk to Magnus personally, but I think he saw my game from round one of the Michigan Open where I played queen to d1. If you were here for my last lecture, aha, that's good preparation. So you gotta hand it to him. Now, queen e2 also doesn't allow g4 as tempo, but the difference is, when white later plays f3, so his bishop can take this pawn, the queen isn't blocking the rook. So in the important variation, g4, f3, gh, bishop takes h4, rook takes g2, gives black the advantage because he's a queen ahead. And then Magnus would lose because he's down a queen. But Magnus saw that variation coming, and he knew that he wanted to play f3, so he didn't play queen e2. He played queen to d1 so that his rook was protecting. And I think the next move is actually the losing move. I think g4 simply loses because now this pawn's not protected. And you know, the further you move your pawns, the less protection they have. And f3 is just a fantastic move. White wants to play bishop takes h4. And then you tell me which is better, the bishop or the knight. And well, now, I've actually had several people ask me, several, why didn't black play g3 here and they're all mad? Why did he get crushed? Well, actually, if you were a computer or a weak player, you would want to play g3 because a computer would think forever and probably say, yeah, g3 is better than gh because gh loses and I don't want to lose. And a weak player wants to play g3 because they don't understand strategical chess, they just push their pawns. Ah! Well, the problem with g3 is that's the end of black's play. Like black can't do anything. White has the c-file, and white's going to play for e4 later, and black just does nothing. And one of my friends here said, well, black should put his knight over here to c6 and just sort of chill out and try to draw. And that's probably better than what he did, but there's no long-term prospects. There's just, I hope white doesn't win. Now here, both sides can win, and that's why black did all of this, so he could break through on the king's side. Although as the computer programs show, It's simply good for white. Bishop takes, pinning the knight. Now there's threats like rook to c8. So king f7, defending the knight, and perhaps preparing to double rooks on the g-file. And this position, since I had Houdini running, I was fairly confident what some of the right moves were. Not totally confident, but fairly confident. And here Houdini suggested a move that I thought was quite strong, but quite difficult for a human to find. But I'm sure Joe remembers it. Spence? Somebody remembers it. White played queen e1. And this is the star move of the game. And after move 27, Magnus's play was impeccable. So if he has a cheating program, he turns it on at the right time. Okay? Because at the beginning of the game, he had to shut off or something. But Magnus, between moves 25 and 50 of this game, that's the best chess I've seen this tournament. Every move impeccable, perfect calculation, perfect understanding. Queen e1 is simply brilliant because when we play rook c7 check and black blocks with the rook, now white can play bishop takes knight and queen h4 check, which wins the game, which is what happened. In certain instances, white's also going to play queen b4 and put pressure on b7. But queen e1 is a fantastic move, and white totally breaks through on the dark squares that black sort of gave up when he was pushing all of his pawns, and now his king is exposed. H takes g2 is probably not the right move. Probably trading rooks is better. But it looks like black's attacking. It looks good. It's unfortunate that sometimes a pawn in front of a king is what's protecting the king. Rook c7 check. And well, now white's attacking. And if you move your king, I'll take the rook, I'll play queen g3 check, and I'll play rook c7. So he blocked, which is correct. Takes, takes. And again, even though queen h4 check is the obvious move, and the move that Owen or Julie would make in less than 1 second, because it's check, and it makes the queen good, and it pins the rook, so it's got to be the best move. Actually, rook c8 is stronger, because the computer says so, and because Magnus says so. You! Queen h4, it's black's move.
Yeah, but king
f7. Right. Not as good as what he did. Right. Yeah. Also, king g6 is possible. And also, you got to be careful, because you're trying to win this pawn, but white's trying to checkmate black. Black's already up a pawn or two, and this pawn's pretty strong. Exactly. So rook c8, queen d6, queen check, king f7, and they perpetual check. No, that's not what happened. Check. Now, after the game, the commentators were questioning, well, not me, were questioning Magnus on why he played the incorrect f4 instead of the stronger queen h8. Well, my computer says they're both about +9, so I think f4 is good enough. Now, also, queen h8 is a very computer-esque move. A human being sees the counterplay for black, which is queen to g3. And now, white's rook on c1 can start running away, and sometimes these positions are actually draws.
Yeah, rook g8 would be completely winning if it wasn't.
Right, rook g8 wins on the spot, except for queen g3. Now, after f4, white is threatening rook g8, which wins on the spot. And after the game, Magnus said he did not see black's next move, and it was the only move, and what a great move, and blah, blah, blah. But it turns out f4 is still a winning move, and it's the best, or one of the two best moves. And now this is a very nice move, rook to g8. King takes rook, queen takes check, and rook c8 mate. And Kamsky played queen a3, which prevents rook g8. It ends in mate, but the wrong side gets mated. So rook g8, queen takes c1. And Magnus, after the game, said he didn't see queen a3. But it turned out his intuition was good in any case. Queen h8, threatening queen f8 mate with advantage. Rook f8 mate with advantage was the alternative. Rook g7, always repeat. Got to the time control, and then played the correct way, which is check, and king takes g2, which we thought was a really hard move for a human to find, but maybe Magnus isn't human. And the idea is very nice. White wants to play rook g1. And the fact that black has discovered check, doesn't matter, because now black's king is in a mating net. Queen f6, rook h1, queen h8, they're all winning. And once again, he played one more accurate move, actually two more accurate moves. Rook gf7. Now, if you're a typical Potzer, not a little less than typical, typical Potzer would think every queen move wins. That's what I thought. In fact, only Magnus's move wins. Right, Justin? What's that? Rook g1, hanging your queen, incorrect. Incorrect. That does win, but for the wrong person. Yeah, I didn't see that. I thought every queen move won, and even if the queen move didn't win, you could like start perpetualing and then play the right move later. But that's not true. Only one move wins here. Anyone?
Queen d8.
Who?
Queen d8.
Yeah, if you remember the game, it's easy. Right. Queen d8. And I put the other moves in my engine and said draw. Okay. And now, rook g1 is the winning threat. And in fact, it was the only winning move after rook h7. Well, that Kamsky's tough. It's like plus 100. And if you play the wrong move, it's equal. And there's only one move that's plus 100. And it's rook g1. And that's what Carlsen played. Approximately. Yeah. You know, black can give a lot of pieces away and not get mated at some point. Although the 17-piece table base announces mate. Okay. Hope there's 17 pieces, otherwise I'd randomly guessed. So rook g1 is the only winning move. And I was actually shocked. After queen a2 check, I thought king f3 check wins and king f1 check wins. That was incorrect. Only one of those moves wins. So it's easy to make the wrong move. You got to figure everything out. And in my opinion, it's the less likely of the two moves that wins. I think the other move is actually, without doing any calculation, looks safer. King f1 is the move that does not win. Right, but king f3 does, check. And the reason it wins is after king f6, we can play queen to g8. And if the king is on f1, black starts checking with the rook and the queen. But now the only check we can do is here, other than giving your queen away. And rook g3, and white's threatening a lot of checkmates. And black doesn't have enough checks, or any. And he didn't resign here, although he could have. He traded. And again, king takes would lose to rook check. So he took with the queen.
One more
percent. Right. And now Kamsky resigned because everything's mate. Queen g5's coming. Queen g8's coming. Rook f8's coming. It's all mate. The easiest mate into is rook f8 and then queen g5 mate. If you play rook f7, then queen g5 mate now. The material is even, but I think queen e2 check is the best move. So, computer does announce mate here. It's like mate, every illegal move mate. So gotta resign. What's that?
What about queen f2?
Queen f2, also good, but good for white.
Resign with the material.
Well, that happens when you're getting checkmated. Yeah. So, in my opinion, that was the game of the tournament, although Carlsen's play between moves 10 and 25 was not the best, but between moves 25 and 50 it was, and that's more important. Got to play good at the end of the game. And there were four or five times that game where he made the only move that won, and some of them were very hard to find. Queen d1 was a great move. The idea of f3 was great. And seeing that rook c2 not only doubled on the c-file, but defended the second rank, that was pretty awesome. And a good start for Magnus, although he hasn't seemed to be able to keep that kind of play up in the late middle game, early end game. But I mean, just it's hard to play well for so many moves. The only person who could possibly do it, other than obviously MVL, would be Paul Morphy. Only Paul Morphy and MVL. That's it. All right, maybe some other people. Well, I said people. Right. Yeah. I've had dinner some of these nights with some of the Grandmaster commentators, and they all agree that Carlsen plays pretty good, and the only person who can play as well as him on a consistent level who could beat him in a match would be Kramnik. So Kramnik plays pretty well too. They think Anand could win the match, but that would be very suspicious. They think if Kramnik won a match, it wouldn't be as suspicious. That would be like reasonable. Both of Hikaru's wins were not just like, you know, equal, better, much better, winning, resigns, like you would expect in some top level games. His games are more of a roller coaster where he was equal, better, worse, winning, losing. And then when he got to between was 30 and 40, he played well and his opponent didn't. That's good recipe for winning. So we'll look at one more game. Now, what was funny about this game that was played yesterday between Kamsky and Nakamura was not only did Nakamura get two whites in a row, and Kamsky got two blacks in a row, it's good to be the number one player. But also, in the game that they were following in this particular line was a game where Nakamura was black, even though Nakamura was white this game. Now, as we're pointing out on the live broadcast, bishop d3 is a common move because then if black plays b5, b4 doesn't attack the invisible knight. And white might decide to play c4, but Nakamura just played knight c3. Now, Kamsky used to play con Sicilians and all kinds of e6 and a6 Sicilians all the time. And then he started playing the Ruy Lopez. And he usually plays the Breyer system, anti-marshals for both sides. I think he should play e5. But Gata lost the first game, and he probably wanted to not just draw this game, but win. So he played sort of a provocative system where both sides would have winning chances, and he would hope that Nakamura would overpress, and then he could win the game, and not just have some boring equal position. So he got his wish. B5. I think he played bishop to d3, but I wouldn't bet my life on it. Bishop to b7. I have the game right here, but so far. Wait, is that it? Oh, that's it. That's even further. Yeah, I think he castled, but how would I know? Okay, he did castle. And this is actually a game Nakamura played Gashimov, which seems very suspicious because the game was drawn in like 13 moves. And those aren't guys that usually draw in 13 moves, so this may have been sort of a non-game. But takes, takes, rook to e1. And now, 90% of grandmasters, including my favorite grandmaster, not Paul Morphy, MVL, plays bishop c5. And then we develop our knight next move, and the bishop is quite good on c5. Nakamura, last year, against Gashimov, who has the coolest first name in chess. No? What? Vugar. Yeah, Vugar Gashimov, who I believe is retired due to his health, played queen b8. Although Nakamura was the one who played queen b8. And the idea is to play bishop to d6 and control the dark squares. Gashimov played queen e2, e5, bishop c7, and they agreed to a draw. And that didn't happen in this tournament, because then it's not allowed to happen in this tournament. So Chris Bird would, you know, put his foot down and something. Okay. But
they would repeat until
that, now you're talking. Okay, but Nakamura didn't play queen e2, he played a4, following my rule. When their pawns on b5, play a4. And as Spencer will tell you, when this happened today, and Carlsen Nakamura was shocked. But if he knew my rule, he wouldn't have been. a4, pawns on b5. Okay, now some of you were wondering why white played rookie one. Well, you shouldn't be in the advanced class then. You should be in the intermediate class. And after rookie one, we're lined up with the black king, which is a good place for your rook. And after b4, we can play knight to d5. And now pawn takes check would be very favorable to white because he would get his piece back. He would have two bishops, a lead in development. This looks like Morphe NN. Pieces all in the back row, horrible. Okay, but Kamsky is better than NN. Well, not most, none of that store-bought NN, that's got a lot of nutrients. Bishop to d6, attacking the h-pawn, queen h5, and this position in my database has occurred twice, and both players were playing very quickly, so I think they knew this position. And in one game, black played king f8, which gets off the file. In the other game, black played bishop takes knight. Black's score in those games was 0. Not too good, although Kamsky kept it up with this game. Okay. He played knight to e7, a novelty. And now Nakamura thought for the first time, and he traded, and played b3. And computer's always saying, white's better, white's better, white's better. And since I'm not allowed to talk in the commentary, the person in my life was saying, white's better, white's better, white's better. So I guess white's better. And here, black played a very strange move. Instead of castling, he played a5, which I thought was strange. But sometimes when I think moves are strange, the players say that's the most obvious normal move. But the other commentators also thought it was strange. So it wasn't just me. Bishop to b2, bishop f6. And now Nakamura thought for 20 minutes. And the two moves in question are bishop takes bishop and e5. And they're both good for white. And this is actually a problem that Gregory Kaidanov told me he has a lot. His opponent makes a mistake in the opening, and then every move is good, and he doesn't know which one to make. Okay. And Nakamura played the correct way the computer recommended, putting pressure on the black king, which really has nowhere to go. If white never plays e5, and black can play queen e5 and king e7, the king will be perfectly safe. But, well, if this pawn is gone, then the king's not too safe. Rook to g8, g3. And actually, my computer program thinks this is very slightly better than rook g8, but it thinks black's in trouble in both positions. But this looked completely crazy to me. So I said, well, he won't do that. And Ian Rogers said, of course he'll do that. And then he did that. So I was wrong as usual. Rook to g5, and this is a pivotal point of the game again, and it shows you what a world-class player Hikaru is. Your typical bad player would play, Ken West.
H6, queen H6.
No, that's what a very good player would play.
Queen takes h7.
Now you're talking, see, now, yeah. Now, the problem with queen h7 is you're winning the h-pawn for this e-pawn, and now the king has the very safe e7 square, and probably black's better. But after queen h6, taking with a pawn is risky because you lose your rook, but you have to take. And now you lose your f-pawn, which means your king isn't a safe, and you'll probably lose your h-pawn later. So this is what happened, and this is a big advantage to white. And Ian expected rook takes rook, but Gata played the computer-recommended rook h5. And now, once again, and I said this before, and I'll say it again as long as it works to my favor. Well, it doesn't work to my favor, I won't mention it. Here Hikaru thought forever and ever and ever and ever. And that's a long time. Right, Ben?
He's still thinking really long.
Yeah, he's still thinking. And he was like, should I go here, should I go here, should I go here? And he made a move that computer's not a big fan of and that we didn't look at all. Computer likes h4 or rook ad1. I like rook ad1 because my rook's better on d1 than a1. I'm simple. But Hikaru played bishop e4. And this move is not the best. And Kamsky immediately played queen d8. Black wants to trade queens because his king is very suspicious. In fact, if black trades queens, Ian thought black had the advantage, and Hikaru agreed. And Akaru thought a while here and played queen f3, attacking the rook, and the rook moved. And now, Houdini says after bishop takes, rook e4, and rook g4, white has the advantage. And in fact, it doesn't like this move at all, queen e3. And when I showed Akaru what Houdini recommended, he's like, nah, that's no good. So Gata played queen e7, and Akaru said, yeah, that's the best move. And I said, well, Houdini doesn't like this move because rook e5, and then you just take everything. And the pawns attack, so h6. And Houdini's like, this is completely equal, and you throw all your advantage away. And he's like, no, I like white. I talked to Alejandro, and he's like, well, computer's not wrong about this position. Some positions it's wrong about, but not this one. So this is probably just equal. But both players do not agree with the computer. I'm sure they both saw rook e5, and they both thought, that's not right. So there you go. I give up. Somebody help. Here?
Black bishop's not on the right square.
Oh, it's on here. Okay. So Gata played queen e7, defending his rook. And that's not bad. That's doesn't lose. It's OK. OK, and Akaru took a pawn, which is what I always do. And then f5, attacking the bishop. Going either way is equally good according to the computer, but all humans go here. And then you can castle next move. Well, generally, you want to play king c7, rook g8, and checkmate your opponent. So you're not going to play king f8. Then you can't mate him. OK, now, Akaru's next move was based on a miscalculation. If he didn't miscalculate, he would have played another move, although his miscalculation was a bit of a miscalculation. So he wasn't as bad as he thought he was. Rook a d1 is probably the best move. He played rook a c1, and the idea is to move the c pawn, c3, c4. After king c7, he changed his mind because after, let's say, c3, we take everything, and we play queen to g5. The bishop has to go to f7. And now, Akaru saw this when he played rook c1, and he thought it was good for white. And then all of a sudden, he saw this, and he thought he was close to losing. In fact, that is the best move. But the computer says it's equal. And we looked at some lines, and he's like, ah, computer. Ah. So, well, even seeing the computer lines, I don't think he likes this. Very suspicious bishop. Now, the key variation, which is actually quite humorous, after queen g4, is there's some sacrifice. Oh, not this. No, this is a later variation, not this one. So he could have played c3, c4, but he decided he miscalculated, so he can't play c3, c4 anymore. Then rook c1 doesn't make a lot of sense. I mean, that's why he played rook c1, was to move his c pawn. But he decided it was bad, and he played bishop h5. Well, the bishop's terrible here. He's getting it back into the game. And, well, black could just play some normal move, like move his rook off of a8 or improve his queen or his rook. But he played e5. Yeah. And we thought e5 was crazy, but somebody said they thought it was normal. I don't know. Maybe Var thought so. Somebody thought it was normal. And, well, it's crazy, but it's OK. And once again, Akaru doesn't have to play f4, but he slightly miscalculated. I hate when you do that. And probably he could play c3, and if f4, he can take, but he was very worried about doing this. Computer says it's okay, but humans don't like it. So he played f4, and this is actually quite funny because Kamsky instantly moved. And Akaru said he didn't look at the move at all. And Kamsky's move is the computer recommended move, which is queen d6. Because now, as you'll notice, when the pawn's on f4, it's not on f2. And if it was on f2 and you cheated and played queen d5, I would play f3. But when you play f4, you're not playing f3. So now Kamsky really wanted to play queen d5. And, well, Hikaru didn't look at queen d6. It's sort of a strange looking move. It doesn't defend the e-pawn. But queen d5 is serious. After the game, he was explaining how proud he was of playing the only move. And I said, well, that's a good move. Another good move is rook to d1. And he was like, well, wait a minute, you take. And I was like, here. And I was like, yeah, humans don't see it. He's like, I saw that. I didn't really accuse him of being a human. And then takes, and then takes. And Hikaru incorrectly thought black could play queen h6. And then the computer put him in his place. Queen takes c5, queen takes h5, and black has lots of threats. But white goes here. I hate when that happens. And actually, even before the computer showed me, he's like, oh, wait, rook d7 just wins. And if king takes rook, rook e7 check, and mate. Otherwise, this, I think his position's about equal. So yeah, he thought he couldn't do this, but he could. Now, luckily he didn't, because the position probably is equal. And the way the game turned out, because of errors by Kamsky, he ended up winning the game. So after f4, queen d6, I thought it was very logical to play rook f1, because if queen d5, I play bishop to f3. Now, one of the funny variations that I was looking at with Ian was queen d5, bishop f3, e4. Normally, you would move your bishop. But then rook c3 is sort of annoying. But white plays c4, a computer move. And the idea is, if you take rook d1, now you're in trouble. Because if your queen moves, you lose your rook. It's unfortunate. So that's why queen d5 doesn't work. I didn't ask Hikaru if he was planning on doing that. But okay, so he played rook f1, and then takes, takes, bishop f4, e4, I'm sorry. And this is an equal position. And we expected Hikaru to trade queens and probably draw the game. And Hikaru's like, that's no good. Queen f2. And queen f2 and queen d6 are computerly equal, but he thought he was worse after that, and after that he thought it was unclear. So unclear is better than worse. That was what he was thinking. He's like, I have to play queen f2. Rook c3, bishop e2, these are fine moves. And now, Gata did it again, okay, soon to be sued by Britney Spears. For the third time in the game, Gata thought a very long time and made a bad move. So maybe you shouldn't think a long time. In fact, we didn't even look at this move, and the move makes very little sense, and Hikaru was shocked. Now, Hikaru had very little time on his clock here, and he totally refuted the move by playing perfectly. I hate when that happens. One move he was afraid of was bishop to b7 with the idea of queen c6 and all kinds of good stuff here. And the computer says bishop b7 is a good move, but everything's always equal for some reason. Everything's all zeros, no matter what happens. Except the move Gata played. Now, Gata played king b7. I assume his reason was silly, because the normal move is something like rook to g8. And you know, we're going to try to do something here. And well, obviously, if the king is on b7, queen a7 check is not a good move. However, as the computer points out, queen a7 is not a good move. King d8, and black's actually winning here. You can't check on the back rank. If you check on a5, I play king e7, and then the queen's ridiculous on a5, and white, black's going to start checkmating white. And it actually gives black a winning position here. So queen a7 check actually is not a good move after rook g8. White should do something else. I don't really understand why you would play king b7 otherwise, so just bad understanding from Gata in this position. Now, the problem with king b7 is it undefends d7. And Hikaru really played accurately. Rook d1, Gata should play queen c7. He made a mistake with queen e6. And I think he overlooked, in this position, the winning move for white, which Hikaru saw with about a minute on his clock. Queen to c5, attacking the pawn many times. And if you take, rook d6 is a mating attack, and it's attacking the queen. And white's winning. And I think Gata just didn't see queen c5. And again, black has good drawing chances if he defends, something like queen c6, and try to be a pawn down and draw. But Gata kept making mistakes in Hikaru's time trouble, played rook d8, defending the d pawn, but undefending the a pawn. The rook is attacked. The b4 pawn is attacked. Rook takes c2, threatening rook check on g2. And again, Hikaru kept playing the best move. Even better than taking the pawn with check, he played rook f2, because now he threatens the rook and the pawn. Gata took, and the computer liked all three captures. All three captures are winning. I think it thought this was the best move, but he took this, which is fine. Rook g2, and now rook h2 is slightly better than rook b2, but they both lose. Rook to b2, and then he just played very simply, check, takes. And then Ian Rogers is like, wow, this is an easy win for white. And after he said that, Gata resigned. And, well, you can take this pawn, take, and this pawn's not very dangerous because I'm going to play rook b5, and then these pawns are pretty dangerous. And probably the best black can do is some end game where you lose this, win this pawn and lose that one, and then no, this is just real easy win. So here Gata resigned. And that reminded me a little bit of the Carlsen win versus Kamsky. Kamsky was doing fine. Kamsky was trying to get an advantage, and then opponent played basically perfectly in time trouble between moves 30 and 40 while Gata was making mistakes, and then when time trouble was over, Gata was losing. And both games sort of went the same way, and boy, it almost went that way today. Gata was better, and then between moves 20 and 30 it turned around. Aronian had the advantage. It looked like it might be 0-3 again, but Aronian couldn't find the right moves to get the advantage, and Gata drew today. But Gata had good positions in all three games where the computer thought he was equal or slightly better, and no points as a result, only one draw.